morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. What an excellent, blessed day that the Lord has provided us. Cooler weather, summer sunshine. What an awesome day to worship our Heavenly Father. We had a great outdoor worship service this morning. 32 people joined us. What a great opportunity to come together, to see each other face to face, to have that communal family feeling. We're going to continue that next week. And next week we will begin incorporating communion into that service. And again, reminder, if you would like to join us, we need you to sign up. You can call the church office, you can email me, and I'm also going to this week set up a Google form, a registration form that you can access from the church website, and you can sign up that way, because Rhonda will be out Monday to Thursday. And so I think actually it's best if you email the church or you email me directly. That's all the announcements I have this morning. We are continuing our sermon series in the book of Ephesians. Dearly beloved, it says we are gathered here. The uttering of these six words immediately calls to mind a wedding ceremony, and with that, the image of a marriage. Bride, groom, minister, witnesses, they all assemble for the celebration of a bridegroom and his bride becoming one. God designed the marital union of one man and of one woman to parallel the union between Jesus Christ and his bride, the church. As our bridegroom, he invites us to come to him. We call to mind all that he has done. With the witnesses who surround us, let us learn to treasure Christian marriage as a beautiful gift that reflects Christ's love for us. We begin prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the blessings that you bestow upon your children. We give you thanks for the gift of eternal life. We give you thanks for your word that strengthens us. Lord, be with us now as we worship you. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Deeds. There is no one who does good, The Lord looks down from the heaven on the children of man to see if there are any who understand, who seek after God. They've all turned aside. Together they have become corrupt. There is none who has done good, not even one. Have they no knowledge? All of the evildoers who eat up my people as they eat bread and do not call upon the Lord. There they are in great terror, for God is with the generation of the righteous. You would shame the plans of the poor, but the Lord is his refuge. Oh, that salvation for Israel would come out of Zion. When the Lord restores the fortunes of his people, let Jacob rejoice, let Israel be glad. Let us confess together. Brothers and sisters, let us together acknowledge that we have turned away from our faithful God. None of us is good, not even one. We all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Therefore, let us come before our Father in heaven and in repentance and faith, seeking his pardon and restoration for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. With humble hearts, let us pray. Merciful Father, have mercy upon us. We have failed to obey your commands. Loving Savior, have mercy upon us. Wash us clean in your saving blood. Comforting Spirit, have mercy upon us. Restore us to be your own. Amen. Because of God's mercy and grace, salvation has come to you. You are forgiven in the Father's eyes, washed spotless by the washing of the water and of the Word. You are united with Christ, so rejoice and be glad. As a called, ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, you cleanse and renew your people through the saving work of your Son, our Bridegroom, Jesus Christ. Grant that we, who have been made spotless by him, ever walk in faithfulness and truth. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. This morning, our first reading from the prophet Isaiah, and the theme here we hear is, the Lord will again do wonderful things with his people. For you, this whole vision is nothing but words sealed in a scroll. And if you give the scroll to someone who can read it and say to him, read this please, he will answer, I can't. It is sealed. Or if you give the scroll to someone who cannot read and say, read this please, he will answer, I don't know how to read. The Lord says, these people come near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship of me is made up only of rules taught by men. Therefore, once more I will astound these people with wonder upon wonder. The wisdom of the wise will perish, the intelligence of the intelligent will vanish. Woe to those who go to great depths to hide their plans from the Lord, who do their work in darkness and think, who sees us? Who will know? You turn things upside down, as if the potter were thought to be like the clay. So what is formed, say to him who formed it, he did not make me. Can the pot say of the potter, he knows nothing? In a very short time, Will not Lebanon be turned into a fertile field, and the fertile field seem like a forest? In that day, the deaf will hear the words of the scroll, and out of gloom and darkness, the eyes of the blind will see. Once more, the humble will rejoice in the Lord. The needy will rejoice in the Holy One of Israel. The word of the Lord. Our second reading is from the book of Ephesians chapter 5, and this will be the basis of meditation. Christ the bridegroom makes the church his bride and gives himself up for her. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which is he the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it just as Christ does the church, for we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, each of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. The word of the Lord. Our gospel reading this morning is from the book of Mark, the 7th chapter. In this reading today, we hear how Jesus rebukes those who reject God's commands in order to establish their own traditions. The Pharisees and some of the teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus and saw some of his disciples eating food with hands that were unclean, that is, unwashed. The Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they give their hands a ceremonial washing, holding to the tradition of the elders. When they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash, and they observe many other traditions, such as the washing of cups and pitchers and kettles. So the Pharisees and teachers of the law asked Jesus, "Why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating their food with unclean hands?" He replied, "Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'These people will honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men.' You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to the traditions of men." And he said to them, "You have a fine way of setting aside the commands of God in order to observe your own traditions. For Moses said, 'Honor your father and your mother,' and anyone who curses his father or mother must be put to death. But you say that if a man says to his father or mother, 'Whatever help you might otherwise have received from me is korban,' that is, a gift to God, then you no longer let him do anything for his father or mother. Thus you nullify the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down, and you do many things like that." The Gospel of the Lord. and sisters in Christ, we continue our sermon series this summer. We're going through the book of Ephesians under the title of Living Life Together. And this morning we're looking at a subset theme of life within the family. Back in 2001, a new website appeared on the dating scene. This website was for married people. That's right, a website for married people looking to have an affair. Surprise? The world around us doesn't really have a clear picture of what marriage is supposed to be. Is it about happiness? Is it about contentment? Is it about marriage that has been defined by the world around you? By what your friends say that you should do? Is it defined as trying to find a partner for the long haul? Today, let's look at St. Paul. And instead of defining marriage by what it isn't, let's look at God's design for what marriage and for our responsibilities and relationships are. You know, one of the greatest stumbling blocks, the stumbling points when it comes to this text on marriage, comes with a quick overreading of our text from Ephesians. In the very first few words that I shared, wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. That's probably not a first choice verse for most marriage ceremonies today. Why? Because in part, because it's often fundamentally misunderstood. You see, when people hear the word submit today, it usually carries the connotation of having to admit that you're weaker than the other party, that you're being forced or coerced into obedience. That's not the kind of relationship that God has planned for his people, especially for husbands and wives. Rather, submission here is a gift given by the wife to the husband. The wife holds her will back, honoring her husband, not because she is forced to, but because she is worshiping God through this act of self-giving love and service. Looking back, you'll see that actually all Christians are to be submitting to one another out of reverence to Christ as part of our life together. Did you catch that? All Christians are called to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Husbands, hold on. Husbands, you don't get a free pass. Far from it. If anything, you're given a more profound responsibility and an awesome task. The very next instruction that Paul communicates here in this lesson He says, "Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her." Did you get that? Husbands, love your wives as Christ has loved the church. In fact, the majority of this passage on marriage is devoted to husbands and what it means to love their wives. As a husband, you are to deny your own self-interest and to put the care of your wife and your family first and foremost. Even children. Children are to respect their parents. God has instructed fathers and mothers to raise their children in the knowledge and the nurture of the Lord. Children are to honor their parents, obey their instruction, as it reflects God's care and instruction for them. Parents, especially you fathers, you are to show your children the grace and the love that your Heavenly Father has shown you by raising them in the love and the grace of God. Exercise patience in teaching them and instilling them discipline, acting unselfishly and caring in all things. You see, this text today is more than just wives submitting to husbands. It's wives honoring their husbands because they love the Lord. It's husbands loving your wives, caring for your wives. Why? Because you love the Lord. You see, we have a vertical and a horizontal axis. The vertical axis is between God and man. God has to be on top. And when God is on top and when we love, honor, and serve him, then on the horizontal axis, then we can relate to one another. Then we can share love with one another. Why? Because God is number one. So, what is marriage? Marriage, simply put, reflects the relationship of Christ with the church. And the church, its believers, with Christ. Marriage is meant to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ by loving all people as imitators of God with Christ, as our template. We have been called to share life together in mutual love and in mutual service. Marriage and family are truly gifts from God. And the home that is built with Christ at its center, not just as the templates for our relationships, but as Lord, marriage and family become what they are meant to be. Means through which God's self-giving love is delivered to us and to the people around us. Whatever else may come, where family lives together in mutual love and humble service in Christ, that home is indeed blessed. Living together, walking together, serving together, loving together. That's the Christian family with its roots in Christ. Amen. This morning, as we gather our offerings, I'd like to thank the congregation, I'd like to thank family and friends for being faithful in your giving to the church. You can download, we have now the capability where you can download an app called Tithely, and you can log in there and search for Redeemer, and you'll be able to make your donations right from your phone. You can also go to our website. There's a picture of our website. In the middle column, there's a button called Online Giving. And then on the top, on the menu bar, there's something called Giving. Our website is richandredeemer.org. And then you can use the old-fashioned way, which is the mail. Thank you for continuing to serve the Lord. Let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This morning, flowers are placed by Roy and Rhonda Wolf in celebration of Rhonda's 60th birthday. We pray for Sash Eilert's mother. She was admitted a few days ago to Catholic. She has now been released. She's due to extreme anemia, and then the doctors found fluid on her heart. Let us pray. We thank you, God, for the gift of 60 years that you have blessed Rhonda with. By your goodness, you have blessed and kept her. On this day, we ask for your blessing in a day filled with hope, joy, and optimism. We pray that this coming year might be one that will bring Rhonda fulfillment and accomplishment. Lord Jesus Christ, we bring before you Sash Eilert's mother, for whom you suffered and died. Grant her strength, peace, and if it be your will, healing. Above all, keep her eyes directed towards your cross, and give her daily reminders of your great mercy toward those who are suffering. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Together as the body of Christ, let us pray the prayer that he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. there's a couple lines in there. Each the other's gladness sharing, each the other's burdens bearing. What does it mean to live together in family? Sharing, bearing, caring, submitting, honoring, and loving. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.